Hello, hello, everyone. Hello, brothers and sisters in Christ. Today is begins the third week of Advent. And now we're thinking about joy. So we're looking at Psalm 5, verse 11. It says, "Hear these words, but let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy. Spread your protection over them, so that those who love your name may exult in you." This week, two of the purple candles have already been lit, and we light the pink candle of joy. You know, often we think of joy as something big, like a big gathering or celebration, something triumphant, but really easily and more often we see joy in little things, love, holding hands, through smiles, through laughter. Lord, help us not to overlook those joys that appear in our daily lives. This week, during our Advent journey, Lord, help us to open our eyes and our hearts and see the joy that surrounds us. Amen. Amen. I just want to add one thing too. You know, joy during COVID might be hard, but we have to think of God and the joy that we have in Him and for Him. He's the number one reason for this season. Yes, and also God is sovereign, and He still shows His love for us through joy. Amen.
Receive her.
Good morning. Good morning, church family. Merry Christmas. Before we begin the lesson this morning, let's pray. Holy, precious Father, we pause for this moment and we give you thanks and praise for who you are, for your constant care over the past week, for gathering us together this morning. Lord, we need to hear from you directly this morning. Give us your spirit. Help us to understand and to apply your word, to learn and grow and become stronger disciples of Jesus Christ this morning. I pray also, Lord, for those who are joining us who maybe don't know you personally. Maybe they know you only in name and, you know, that you're related to the church, but don't really know your spirit, don't have your spirit inside them transforming their lives. I pray that your spirit would help those people as well this morning. I ask that you bless our time. May our attention, our focus, and our motives honor you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So last week, Advent began, and I know for many of us, after this year, we really need Christmas. We need the gatherings. We need family. We need a celebration. We need everything to work out. We need this time together. You know, maybe after this crazy election year, Christmas can help us rebuild again. But we definitely need Christmas this year. And you know, 2020 is not the first time that his people really needed Christmas. It's not the first time that people have been looking for better days ahead and for hope. God's people long ago waited and waited, anticipated and expected the Messiah, Jesus, the chosen one. And you know, I think sometimes we forget that the world back then was a really dark place. It was dark. They'd been waiting and waiting for many years. And when I say many years, I mean generations and generations. You know, grandfathers waited and died waiting for the Messiah. Fathers waited and died waiting for the Messiah. Sons and grandsons. And finally, the light came. Jesus had come. The angels sang, "Hallelujah, the Messiah is here." This year, we can celebrate God's amazing grace. We can enjoy the Messiah. Those people back then are our brothers and sisters, those who are struggling for hope yet remained faithful during difficult times. We too have been struggling. And I think it's important this year that we remember the rest of his plan. And that's what I want to emphasize this morning and for the next few weeks through Christmas Eve. Because Christmas reminds us that yes, Jesus came, but also that he will come again. So we gather and celebrate, worship, we eat together, and we create these memories. We look back just yes, on Jesus' birth, but also his work on the cross. But his work for his people is not finished. He will come again. And when Jesus comes again, he will reign forever. And that is the hope that we have. It's our hope for today that we can look forward to in anticipation, but it's also our hope for the future. So let's open our Bibles now and let's look at rebuilding that hope in Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 28. There will be strange signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. And here on earth, the nations will be in turmoil, perplexed by the roaring seas and strange tides. People will be terrified at what they see coming upon the earth, for the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then everyone will see the Son of Man, Jesus, coming with power and great glory. So when all these things begin to happen, stand and look up, for your salvation is near. Of course, reading verses 25 and 26, we could say that that's a pretty good description of 2020. Strange signs, nations in turmoil. The passage is not really what we think of when we think of the Christmas story, but Luke's writing here is helpful. And I don't have time to go into a whole lot of detail like I normally do, but this passage describes the end times. And this was written during Jesus' last hours here on earth. You know, of course, he'd been arrested and persecuted, and his death was imminent. Jesus wanted his disciples to understand that when life seems most confusing and awful, and there is just widespread fear and discouragement, when most people would just give up, God's people can have hope. Because Jesus said, "I'm coming again." And that is a promise that we should be celebrating during Christmas. But the problem is that if we're not careful, we can fall into a trap at Christmas time, a trap of confusion, a trap of thinking that Christmas, the event of Christmas itself, that specific time of year, should make everything better, right? I mean, we tend to behave that way. We think that Christmas should make us feel better, that it should help us feel joy and peace and love and hope. Is that true? Not always. And yes, again, we tend to fall into that trap. But it's not actually true. Christmas itself cannot create joy. It can't create peace or love or hope. Now, maybe Christmas can distract us for a while. Sure. Keep us busy, keep us uplifted, just rolling along and temporarily forget the past year, all of these awful experiences and frustrations we've had from quarantine, from trying to raise our children in a being a virtual environment, trying to work from home and teach our kids from home and make sure they're doing their schoolwork, and you know, all of these things we've tried to juggle, and not being able to get out and going stir crazy. But if we're looking for true, lasting peace, lasting joy and love and hope, then we have to understand something important. That only happens through Jesus Christ. We can look forward to, expect, believe, and trust that Jesus will return and he'll take reign here. And life with him will be pure, sinless, without pain, without grief, without failure, without coronavirus, beyond what we can possibly imagine. And I hope this year, well, this week and next week, as we approach Christmas, I hope that we'll avoid that trap, avoid that confusion this year about Christmas. Life with God the Father, relationship with him through Jesus Christ, that is where we find eternal joy. Eternal joy. It's not happiness and just a break from all that's going on. It's true joy. Joy means genuine, lasting contentment, confidence. But if you have no personal relationship with God, if you don't know who Jesus Christ is and what he's done for you, honestly, all that you do to give your time, spend time with family and friends, it really doesn't matter. And you may have a great time doing it. You may create wonderful memories in doing so. But all of that will not give true joy. It won't. I mean, think about it. If we could indeed find true joy through Christmas itself, meaning the time of year, the season, the celebrations, all of that, the shopping, the parties, if we could find true joy through that, then when Christmas is over, we should still have that joy, but we don't. Why is that? I mean, if Christmas is giving us joy, then what happens after Christmas is over? Not just that it's gone, you never truly had it. Your Christmas may feel special, and I hope your Christmas does feel special. Maybe your children, your spouse, your friends are truly happy, exchanging gifts and spending time together, reconnecting with old friends. All of those are great feelings. They're awesome, yes. But they're not lasting. They can't last because we can't create joy. True joy is found. It's found through Jesus alone. Before Jesus died, he described it. He said that we must have a permanent connection with him to have joy. In order to have joy, you have to have a permanent connection with him. We took two verses here from John chapter 15. Jesus said, "I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who remain in me, and I in them, will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." I've told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. So that connection there is critical. A fulfilled life, a meaningful life, a joyful life, and most importantly, an eternal life cannot happen without Jesus Christ. It's impossible. Joy, like it says in verse 11, joy happens only with God through Jesus. So what you've thought was joy, what you've thought is joy that you're experiencing, if you don't belong to the Lord, it's not true joy. Again, it may be great feelings. You may have wonderful memories. But if you don't belong to Him, it's not joy. Because God created joy. God defines joy. And most importantly, God offers joy for anyone who submits their lives to Him. For anyone who allows them to rescue them, allows Him to rescue them. So now what about peace? Genuine peace. Do you have it? I'm not talking about feeling good, the peace sign. Does that mean we just have to turn off the news and close our work laptop for the day to get peace? Set up the Christmas tree and make cookies? Is that peace? No. Again, those are great things. They bring us a lot of pleasure. They help us relax for the time being. But they don't give lasting peace. Because true peace, again, is found in God the Father. We believe in Jesus' work on the cross for our forgiveness, His death for our sins, which means we belong to the Father forever. But also, it means that all of those internal struggles, those spiritual questions, those doubts, that emotional baggage, past pains, with His Spirit's help, all of those things we can confront. We don't have to sweep under the rug. We can confront them, deal with them, resolve them. All of those battles, the spiritual, emotional, physical battles, we can surrender it all. We can trust in God's wisdom for a solution. And it may take a while. Yes, some people have lifelong challenges because, you know, we say, okay, I'm going to trust and let go. But then what happens? The evil one starts to pick on us, starts to feed us doubts. And so we grab those problems back and we try to resolve them ourselves. We dwell on them and we start worrying all over again. It's exhausting. It's an exhausting cycle. But you know what? God is patient. He is stubbornly patient. He won't give up on you because He wants you to experience genuine peace. He wants you to trust Him with your worst fears, your loneliness, your illness. And I'd add to, He wants you to trust Him with just your everyday anxieties. Maybe your relationship with your parents, your work, your school, all of it. You can give to Him. If we go back to Luke, it means that we can't allow fears and discouragement, and all of that anxiety to push away our peace. Remember, God gave you peace through His Son, just like joy that I talked about. Again, Christmas, the season, will not bring peace. If a holiday could create peace, I mean, it makes no sense. Like, if a holiday or a period of time could create peace, then why do we see suicide rates rise so high? And why do we see divorce rates climb after the holidays? If it truly brings peace and joy, we wouldn't see that. We want to believe in Christmas, but Jesus is saying, no, believe in me. Believe in me. One day, I will bring peace on earth. Isaiah 9, verse 7 says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. It will never end. Eternal peace. Lasting peace. I mean, can you imagine what that looks like, what that would feel like? It's hard. It's hard to imagine because our entire lives, we've experienced spiritual warfare, struggles, battles, challenges. The evil one discourages us, destroys our life, our health, robs our innocence, steals our beauty. So again, imagine all of those struggles, personal, relational, physical, one day being gone forever. Wow. But you know, now we have his peace too. We can have his peace because we have his spirit within us. God himself, his own spirit, has been given to us. Remember, before Jesus left the earth, he told his disciples, he said, my gift that I give you is peace of the mind, peace of the heart. My peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. Don't let your hearts be troubled. My spirit will be with you. God himself, the Holy Spirit, will be with you, and you will have true peace. Again, so many people become trapped during Christmas time. As we get to the end of the year, everyone's just hoping 2021 will be better. I mean, people think it just couldn't get any worse. Well, I'm telling you, it could be a lot worse. God has shown a lot of grace this past year. So yes, we want 2021 to be better. We're looking forward to a successful vaccine, economic growth, conflicts in other countries settling down, being resolved. We're hoping for these things. Maybe they'll happen. But go back to Luke 21. All of the bad things that Jesus described there. But what did he say? Did he say, oh, don't worry, everything's fine? Nope. Actually, Jesus said, expect those things. Expect those events. Verses 25 and 26 say, the nations of the earth will be in terrible pain. They will be puzzled by the roaring and tossing of the sea. Terror will make people faint. They will be worried about what's happening in the world. But for us who follow Christ, our confidence is in verse 27. At that time, when all is in chaos, when everything's a mess, at that time, people will see the Son of Man, Jesus, coming with power and great glory. Now, we don't know when that'll happen. But his people, wow, have great news that Jesus will come. All will see him. All will look to him. All will bow before him. Those who follow Jesus Christ, we will bow with joy and celebration, honor and praise. Those who have rejected Jesus, they will bow too. But they will bow in fear and in guilt. Now, signs, let's talk about signs. I mean, weather disasters, wars, I mean, we've seen it with fires in California and hurricanes battering the coasts. There's a lot of scary things out there, but it's not surprising. I mean, that's what the Bible describes. This world will end. God will judge. But also, those different events, they warn us. They warn us. In God's loving, kind way, he's reminding us, hey, this isn't forever. This world is not forever. And he wants us to run to him. Run to Jesus. Run to Jesus while we have time. Before it's too late. Because he loves you. He wants you to belong, to be a part of the kingdom. He wants you to call him Father, to worship and praise and honor him forever. He wants you in heaven with him. Jesus came as a sweet, innocent baby in the manger, and he died for your life with God. I mean, that was the whole point of him coming. John 3:17, God sent his Son into the world, not to judge the world, but he sent his Son to save the world through him, through his death and his resurrection. Brothers and sisters, my prayer for you during this season of Christmas is that you would know and celebrate what Advent really means, what Christmas really means. All of the looking forward to having a break, I mean, that's great. But in our hearts and our minds, remember and hold fast to Christmas's true meaning. What is temporary is really worthless, and what is eternal is precious. That's what matters the most. That's where we need to focus. And when Christmas is over, the tree is taken down, either thrown out or packed in a box again. When the family is gone, things have settled down, what will you be left with? Despair? Wishing? Disappointment? No. Full of hope, overflowing hope, because Jesus has come. And Jesus will come again. Again, Merry Christmas. Amen.
Dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe.